I start off with this. This is a presentation track back. This is a track back to Joseph Jaffe from Across the Sound and Jaffe Juice, author of the book Life After 30 Second Spot. He puts up his audio comment line to his podcast, and I thought it's a great idea. So that's my audio comment line. It's +1 206 666 6056. And the reason I do this is because, as Joseph says, presentations should be conversations also. So if you have a question or something you want to talk about, I'll be here all weekend. We can definitely hang out and talk. But what I'd like you to do is to call it into the show, because what better way to build a community than to share the question? And this way I can respond to it in the podcast, and we can all connect and people can get some feedback from it. So audio comment line, you can find it on your own. I'm going to introduce you to a guy to start off, to really sort of define what personal branding is. This is Scott. Does anyone know Scott? Has anyone heard of this guy? Raise your hand. Donna? Of course. Scott. Scott's been wearing a name tag every single day, 24 hours a day, for like the past 3,000 days. And he does it for one sole reason: to build his personal brand, to have people approach him and say, "Hi, Scott, I'm Mitch." One simple act to make people connect to him and start a conversation. Now you might ask, well, what? He's actually in Ripley's Believe It or Not for wearing a name tag the longest, believe it. No, I kid you not. If the name tag falls off, he does not lose his status, because underneath he has a tattoo that says, "Hello, my name is Scott." So he's got it tattooed on his skin. It's pretty awesome. And again, he was thinking of one simple way to get people to connect to him. What does he do for a living? He writes books and speaks about the art of being approachable. So imagine how simple that is. I mean, I think everybody in this room can think of one thing that they can do to make themselves memorable. I'm going to point out my friend Mark Levis, who does a podcast called Just One More Book. The podcast is him and his wife going into a cafe, and they review children's books, which is brilliant in and of itself. But today he came up to me and gave me, instead of a business card, a bookmark with the podcast on it. Very, very memorable. And I told him right away, I said, "I'm going to remember this forever." Simple way, no technology, very low tech. So you can do it. By the way, he's got a podcast. Hello, my name is Podcast. So he actually has a podcast where he helps people figure out how to be more approachable. Today, I'm going to talk to you about what I think builds personal brands. I'm going to talk to you about what a personal brand is and all that stuff. Don't worry, I just want to sort of set the stage for you. For me, it's about three types of conversations. There's the internal conversation is the first one. The second one is the one-to-one conversation. And the third one is a one-to-many conversation. And you'll see how these roll out for businesses and how amazingly powerful it can be for you in terms of understanding what your podcast is and what it's supposed to be and how to connect to the right people. Is that cool? Is everyone awake?
Yep.
Oh, yeah. Yes? Good. Okay. So what? Who cares? Why do you need a personal brand? If you're trying to build community, if you're trying to add more value to society, if you want to make more money, if you want to connect to more people, if you want to be more effective in a PTA meeting or more effective in a business meeting, you need to understand your personal brand and how it connects to others. It's really, really important. So that's the so what. How many people have heard this? Words account for 7% of all communication, right? We know that to be truth. Do we all agree? Does that make sense? Of course it does to podcasters, right? A lot of people would say, wow, it's a really low percentage. I would think it's a lot more. And how I translate that in terms of what I do is simple. Your personal brand is screaming so loud, I can hardly hear a word you're saying. Your personal brand is screaming so loudly, I can hardly hear a word you're saying. Everything you are, everything you're projecting, is way more important than the words you're saying. It's a powerful concept, so you really got to start embracing that when you're thinking about the podcast world. So this is the problem with personal branding. You can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. That's what a personal brand is. Right now, no matter what, you've been developing, nurturing, and executing a personal brand. Whether you like it or not, others have a certain way of feeling who you are, what you stand for, and what you're about. Do you agree?
Yeah.
That's good. Who are these guys?
Gods.
Gods? People? Apple?
Yeah.
How do you feel when I show you that image? What do you feel? Just throw out words.
Happy.
Empowered.
Empowered. Happy. Keep going.
Easy.
Broke.
Not like that.
Broke.
Student loan.
So what's interesting here is nobody said packaging, nobody said commercials, nobody said logo, nobody said colors, nobody said any of those words. So personal brand is not the materials. and it's not the logo, it's not the name, it's not the packaging. What it actually is, it's when all those things come together, it's how we feel about them. What are our emotions? How do we connect to it? What's our relationship to it? Did you hear all the words people threw out? So normally I talk about branding, the first people say is, we need a branding program. What's the logo gonna be? And we do that. Don't we all do that? We're all guilty of that, right? So it's really important to be able to recognize, first of all, what a brand is. Personal branding is really interesting. And this guy, Barry, this is Barry from the band 3 Days Grace, great rock band, I don't know if you know 3 Days Grace are. Barry really gets personal branding. Because in the regular world of branding, the world that I come from, which is I'm brought in to speak to big brands and help them acknowledge how can they speak to everybody? How do they have these conversations? The first thing a brand has to do at a corporate level is they have to differentiate. Have we all heard that? Branding is about differentiation. So what they do is they actually sit in a room and they go, how are we different? That's the first question we ask. How are we different from our competitors? That's what corporations ask, right? We are very lucky as podcasters because we are human beings and no two human beings are alike, right? We're like snowflakes. So no two human beings. So our personal brands are already pre-differentiated. You follow where I'm going with this? So this isn't something where I want you to sit down now and figure out, how am I different from Chris Brogan or John Wall or Donna? How am I different from them? I don't have to figure that out. We all know we're all different. We just have to take a quick look and vibe from it. So Barry sums it up best. You look at me and laugh because I'm different. I look at you and laugh because you're all the same. Barry, through music, through visual, is able to take that differentiation, that uniqueness, and even step it up a notch. And that's what I'm hoping at the end of this session, everybody in here can do with their podcast. Because I'll tell you something, your podcast is not your podcast. You are your podcast. Your podcast is actually the community. You have no control over that podcast. All you have control over is you and your brand. Is that clear? Yeah? Let's talk about that first internal conversation. This is the Dr. Phil segment of the show, right? The internal conversation. It is, because you have to be able to figure out, who am I? And I say this because if you've ever heard it, like personal branding or motivational speakers, the first thing these people do when they talk about how to improve your life is tell you how to be different from who you are. You know, make eye contact. I don't like to make eye contact, you know. Follow their breathing patterns. I have my own breathing patterns. You know, be like them. You know, try and be like the people that you keep your, you know, why? I want you to dig deep and try and find out who you are and then figure out how do I connect that with people who are like-minded. See, this is a really easy presentation for me to give. You know why? Because I'm in my community. This is my community. You guys are like-minded to me. This is really easy stuff for me. I don't have to twist arms here, right? Because by finding the real me, I've connected to my community. So few people will do this. Whenever I talk, I tell people, the tragedy of talking publicly is that the people who are here in this room aren't the people who need to hear this message. It's everyone out there. It's the reality of it, right? What's your story? And my mother asked me this question for about the first, I'm 35, so the first 35 years of my life. My mother's spent asking, what is your story? And what I'm going to ask you is, what's your story? And I don't mean the bio on the about page of your typepad, because you're lying, by the way. Because you wrote it as if someone else wrote it for you. I want you to write your story. That's one action I want you to take at one point in your life, is write your story out. Handwritten too, because the way you write by hand is very different than the way you type. And I want you to write your story as if it's a story. I want there to be mystery. I want there to be romance, murder, death, anguish, passion, romance, suspense, problems, how you overcame them. Because in that story, something is going to pop out, and I call that your unique ability. It's what it is that is you. You might have heard this, the sweet spot. Right, we've all heard the sweet spot? I want you to find the sweet spot. Because when you find the sweet spot, you found your content for your podcast. That's the sweet spot. Too many podcasts, in my opinion, I don't know how you guys feel, are people who are trying to talk about something. Not people who are something and they're explaining it to the rest of us or sharing with us. You follow what I'm saying? Is that clear?
Good.
This is Glenn. Glenn looks a lot like I do Friday afternoon before I come home. I'm sure we all feel this way. But Glenn understands the internal conversation. I want to play for you a TV commercial. I'm going to put the mic down so you can hear it. I want you to listen to the lyrics of this commercial. Cool? see if this works. It should. Can you hear it? It's coming through the screen. So, Mike over here, Mike from
This Week in Geek
said, I want a theme song. And, yeah, we'll get to that in a second. But
the guy in tights in the band behind her.
So, Glenn, right, he doesn't want to be the vice president. He's not trying to be the CEO. One day, hopefully, maybe, supervisor, right? Internal conversation, the power of it. And what's great about that is I always listen to that and I go, who wouldn't want the rock band Survivor doing the Eye of the Tiger theme from Rocky as you're going to work every day? Right? It's a very powerful thing, that internal conversation, knowing what is. I think Survivor telling your internal conversation is a pretty powerful thing. I'm going to talk to you about a company that really gets it. What does Harley Davidson do? What do they manufacture? Motorcycles, right? They do motorcycles.
Yeah, way more than lifestyle.
Way more, exactly. It's lifestyle. Right, Harley Davidson said exactly that. They said, we're not an automotive or motorcycle manufacturer. We're about the open road, we're about freedom, we're about the American way, we're about expressing ourselves. And Wall Street said, you're a motorcycle manufacturer. And Harley kept pushing back with the open road and freedom and the American way. And Wall Street finally gave in and said, you are about the experience, that's fine. And the difference was a couple of zeros, right? A couple of zeros that take you from millions to Austin Power billions, right? Billions of dollars. They got it. But this is what they say. What we sell is the ability for a 43-year-old accountant to dress in black leather, ride through small towns, and have people be afraid of him. That's what Harley Davidson does. The internal conversation. What are our values? What are our goals? What are our beliefs? We don't sell wheels and metal and leather. We sell experience. That's what we do. And what I'm trying to get at here is, when you're going through that first part of the conversation for yourself, is what is that experience for your podcast? Like, how many people in here really know it, can really nail it like that? And it's a challenge. You're like, spend all week doing it, spend all weekend. Share with others, get other people excited about it, see if it works. Because that is Summit, right? The Summit is when that experience is so big that people are willing to tattoo it on their heads. So when you're doing your internal conversation for your podcast, tattoo would be sweet, but could you be a mental tattoo for somebody that when they see you, they know? You know, I see John Wall, I think entertainment. That's how I feel. He's got an experience. I wouldn't tattoo that anywhere. Maybe after a couple drinks tonight, though. We'll see how that goes. Okay, let's move to the one-to-one conversation. This is probably one of the toughest conversations because it's this. You come into a room, you may know a couple people. How do you connect them? How do you share? How do you tell them what you do without sounding like a doofus? And then how do you create and extend it beyond that? So I'm going to run through it. The first thing is, in business, they have this thing called the elevator pitch. How many people here know what an elevator pitch is? Okay, good. Yeah, it's a smart room. You'd be surprised. I've gone through rooms and people don't know. 30 seconds. You walk into an elevator. Door's about to close. Door gets jammed open. Body walks in. Guy walks in next to me. You turn. You're like, wow, I've been trying to connect this person. It's the CEO of M Audio. You just want to talk to him about stuff, like getting a free USB pre-whatever amp thing. You've got 30 seconds to tell them what you do, right? Is that what an elevator pitch is? It's not. You have 30 seconds to start a relationship. You don't have 30 seconds to tell them what you do, and that's the biggest problem that I've seen in elevator pitches, especially for individuals, is that they're trying to sort of, I'm an accountant. You've got to create the experience so that stuff happens. So let me give you the tips on how to build the pitch, first of all. One is clear messaging. You need to be very, very clear about what you do. It has to be right in there. It's got to be short. You don't have a lot of time. You really got to bring it home. It's got to roll off your tongue. It has to sound really, really natural, okay? And the last one is, most important, has to be memorable. But really making it work is all about starting a conversation. When you're done, when that elevator door opens and the person's about to leave, you want that person to answer back something in the form of, "That was really interesting. You have 5 more minutes for me. I'd like to meet you in my office. Can we meet for coffee later? Can I buy you lunch next week?" Because the person is interested and engaged in what you said. You started a relationship in those 30 seconds. So whenever you're in business or in your personal life or even building for your podcast, when people say you need an elevator pitch, don't think about what you can tell them in 30 seconds. Think about how you can intrigue them to engage in a conversation that resonates with really who you are. Dr. Phil. Good old Dr. Phil. You know, I use him as an example because there's a formula for building that elevator pitch. I call it the "you know when, what I do." You know when, what I do. See, Dr. Phil doesn't say to you, "I'm a psychologist." He doesn't tell you, "I'm a TV star." He doesn't tell you, "I'm a successful author." He'll say something like, "You know when your relationship's in trouble or you're having family issues and you're not sure how to get through them and times are really tough? What I do is, I give you tactics, tools, and solutions to your problems." Huh, how do you do that? Well, I, guess what just happened? The conversation started. Because how many times has someone said to you, "I'm a psychologist," and you go, "Hmm." That's not a conversation opener. He engages you because in saying those 4 extra words, "You know when, what I do," you know when you have a toothache? What I do is I make sure it's a, "You're a dentist." Oh, okay. It aligns it with you. I understand that. I can get aligned with that. This is one of the biggest things podcasters probably don't spend enough time doing. I wasn't thirsty. I take that pause for dramatic effect. Because we spend a lot of time talking, and we don't spend enough time listening. And people tell you to be an active listener. We all know that, right? Be an active listener. I don't know what that means. I'll tell you what I do know. I do know that when I'm listening to people and not thinking about what I'm going to say next, I actually hear and understand what they're looking for, where they're going, and I try and connect them, if not through me, through someone else that can help resolve that. Because in the end, it's not about me, it's about them, right? Is it about you or is it about your audience? It's about your audience, obviously, right? That's a no-brainer. Same thing for building your personal brand. Listen. Listen when you're podcasting. Listen to your consumers. Listen to your listeners. Listen to the people who are advertising on your show. Listen to them. They're going to tell you what they want to hear. Help them get that. This is probably the hardest part of building your personal brand, the one-to-one conversation when you're meeting people and trying to connect. Because when we're kids, what's the first thing that our parents tell us about strangers? Don't talk to strangers. I never talk to strangers. Well, we're all adults now. Nobody really looks too psychopathic in here. A couple people, Briper, scaring me a little, I gotta be honest. Just kidding. Penn, you're not so innocent yourself. No, I'm just kidding. The whole point here really is that I really want you to start talking to strangers. In fact, spend all of your time talking to strangers. The only way you're gonna build your audience and build your personal brand is if you talk to strangers. I hate going to events and being the guy, you see these people all the time, you go to an event, they're standing at the bar, and they're just standing there talking to the same people they know, and they leave and they're all pissed off, I didn't meet anybody, it sucked. You know? If you leave PodCamp not having met 150 people, you didn't come to PodCamp. You came to some place, but you're really by yourself. You weren't trying to build your personal brand. You weren't trying to build your audience. You weren't trying to learn. One-to-one conversations will give you such a huge audience, will connect you in ways you can never imagine possible. Always talk to strangers. How many people have heard this? It's all about who you know, Mitch. That's the problem. I don't know a lot of people. I try and network, but it's all about who you know. Raise your hand. You agree? It's all about who you know? Yes? They're like, "Oh, it's a trick question. I'm not sure. It is a trick question." Because it's not. It's about who knows you. Right? It's about who's plugging into you. What are you doing that's getting people to want to connect to your community? Because what you do also is a community, right? Do we agree? You're building community. Financial Aid Podcast, you're building community. Traffic Con News, you're building a community. We're building these communities. That's the power of it. It's all about who knows you. Now, this is easy for audio geeks. I put up this slide and people think it's phallic in every other environment. This, everyone's like, "I get it," right away. Because what I want you to do in building your personal brand in that one-to-one conversation is I want you to plug into other people. I don't want them to plug into you. I want you to plug into them. I want you to be in their loop. I want to know when I read something about financial news, I'm going to forward over to Chris. Or when I read something about Canadian podcasting, over to the Canadian Podcasting Buffet guys. That's what I do. Something socially driven in Montreal, it's over to Julian. Something about pets photography, over to Marco. That's what we do. I plug myself into other people. It's a very, very powerful tool. Not many people get that. They're like, what do you mean? I don't have money. I can't do that. You don't need money. You need Google Reader. You know, you need an RSS feed for people you're connected to. You need Google News Alerts. Google News Alerts your friends' content. Google News Alerts their competitors and let them know, hey, I saw this. I saw this press release. Great stuff. Or do you know someone else is doing that? The best compliment I ever got in my life, I kid you not, was a large company that we were pitching for our business. Wednesday afternoon, I get an email with an attachment to a PDF article. The guy says to me, I was reading the New York Times on Sunday, saw this article, thought of you, gave it to my receptionist, had her scan it, and I sent it on to you. That's personal branding. Guy from a huge company who I met once during a pitch was thinking of me on Sunday afternoon when he's in his underwear. That's pretty cool. Yeah, as Julian just said, that's hot. So I'm going to give you a challenge. Are we up for a challenge this weekend? Yes?
Yeah.
That's not a challenge, Rand. Are we up for a challenge?
Yeah!
He's very ready for a challenge, this man over here. I want you to create 3 networking opportunities for yourself. 3 in the next week. 3 one-to-one conversations, okay? Do we feel we can do that?
Yes.
You know, absolutely. Some people are saying yes and absolutely, so we're eager. But there are some faces over here with the arms folded and the head shaking, the lip went up a little like, I got to take the kids to soccer. I have 4 proposals due, and I have my clients on me like no one's business. 3 conversations, 3 networking opportunities are this simple. Turn to your right, ask the person if after the session you can spend 15 minutes getting to know them. Turn behind you and say, during lunch, why don't we sit together? And tonight, make a plan before say what to go for a drink with someone else. You're done for the week. 3. Because that's the first thing we think of when I say networking. People go, I have to buy a ticket to a Chamber of Commerce event in the next week? How am I going to do that? You know? This is networking. Everything you're doing right here, right now, is networking. Right? John Wall and I never met. We networked, essentially, at PodCamp Boston, and we are good friends. 1-to-1 conversations. 3 networking events. Good? Yes?
Yes.
Good. Woo-hoo. If it works, this is where you'll get. Would you like to sit next to you at dinner? This is an ad for The Economist. The Economist does great advertising. And the message here really is, are you that interesting? You know, are you that interesting? So I'm hoping in your one-to-one conversations and your ability to connect that you really make people feel it. Is that cool? Would you like to sit next to you at dinner? You gotta ask yourself that question. When you're doing these personal branding exercises, you have to be able to ask this. Because if the answer is no, you gotta figure out what is it about me that I'm not connecting to others. And again, don't be fake. Try and find people you can connect to. You know, there's people at MySpace. MySpace, all these places, online social networks, you can connect to people all over the world who have the same interests as you. I haven't blogged about this but I have this theory. And my theory, and it's based off the one-to-one conversation, is that the divorce rate is gonna dramatically drop in the coming years, probably to the point where we would not have believed it possible. How? Online social networking and dating sites. I believe that a lot of people got married based off of the best that they could in the geographic location for where they were. They were limited to a small group within their network of who they connected to. I believe that through dating sites and online social networking sites, you will be able to find more people who are more like you, no matter where they are in the world, and these people are gonna connect, and they're gonna form a sincere and deeper relationship, probably, because they're like them. They're looking for people who are more like them instead of trying to find someone who's sort of like them or the best they could do. And I'm not saying your partner isn't the best, you know, obviously they're the best right now. But we know divorce rates right now today. But we know divorce rates are about 50%. So I want, like, think about the power of that. I know that I'm connecting to more people in a community that is not geographically centric. It's a powerful idea. One-to-one conversations. Aww. How did my puppy dog get in here? That's so weird. I'm just kidding. Giver's game. The whole idea of the one-to-one conversation, the whole idea of personal branding is about giver's gain. There's this saying from this semi-famous book, Give and Ye Shall Receive. I don't know if you've ever read it. It's not that popular. It's not that good. It's all fiction. The point of it really is this. The more you give, the more you get, right? And people go, well, I've been giving all the time. I don't get much. You got to believe in that serendipity luck account. It's a bank account that sits right there. And every time you give, there's a deposit made. And it may not be from the person that you connected with, but stuff does happen. Magic does happen. You just have to have faith in that. There's this movie out now that's getting all the buzz, The Secret. If you've heard about it, all about the law of attraction. Not that I'm a huge fan of the movie. I think it's okay. But the concept is really simple, right? If you give, if you put it out there, if you really define what you want, the world revolves around that. Stuff does happen. So it's really powerful. I want you to start embracing that. Let's move to the one-to-many conversation, because this is probably the most difficult one. We talked about the internal conversation, right, Harley Davidson? We talked about the one-to-one conversation, networking, Gene Simmons rolling off your tongue. The one-to-many conversation is probably the biggest dramatic change in marketing communications that we've seen ever. Because traditionally, if you're Harley Davidson, you talk about the accountant riding through a small town. You test drive this, you focus drive it, you get people to try it out. People go, man, this is an amazing experience, right? And then, what do they do to get the message out to millions of us? How do they do it?
Advertising.
Advertising and PR, right? And how much does that cost, Chris?
Lots of money.
Lots of moolah, right? Lots of dineros. It's a lot to advertise. In fact, it costs, you know, billions of dollars you can spend on it. 30-second Super Bowl spot, $2.5 million this year. It's a lot of money to get your message out. But something magical has happened in our world, and we call it technology. And we have the web, and we are now connecting. And the individual now can have a one-to-many conversation very, very easily, very, very effectively. How did this happen? One, we're connecting, right? The days of the what was that, dial-up? Well, anyone here have dial-up still? They're trying to get you off it. They're trying to get, if you probably don't have access where you are, or see, okay, geographic issues. You got to move. Yeah. Most people who are on dial-up in Canada, just so you know, it's because we don't know why, and they're trying really hard to get you off of that because they just want to do away with it. We are connected. I don't care if I get an email on my BlackBerry from London, Ontario, or London, England. It doesn't matter. We are all connected now, right? The next big thing that's happening in our world is this real power. And this is probably the biggest one that I don't think people in this room are really embracing. Real power simply says this. Never before in society have you had the ability to go about your day-to-day job. But whenever you wanted to, you can affect real change in the world. What do you mean by that? How many people know the story of a kid who gets sick in a family? Family starts a website, maybe talking about the ailment, what's happening, the treatment, how it's going. Really, they do it to keep their family from a distance in the loop, right? We've heard about these stories. And then the next thing that happens, other families discover this and their kid has that problem and they connect. And next thing you know, the family start posting news and updates on the site. And the next thing you know, the news crew comes from the local news crew and wants to do a story about the site and how people are connecting to it. The next thing you know, the family does a charity drive for it and raises all sorts of money for the cause. The next thing you know is the family is seen as the central hub of that issue. They circumvented the health associations, the government, the drug companies. They are the hub. Real power. They commanded it through one channel, the web. They leverage the crowd to make it happen. Real power. We all have that in your podcast, right? Your podcast is real power. You have a voice that's equal to, right? When you go into iTunes, your voice is as equal to BBC, CBC, all of that. It's as equal. It's what you do within your personal brand to get it as popular. That's the other thing. Creating. And this is a big thing too. I don't think anybody in this room really appreciates what has happened here online. We went through this online world, people were pushing up these websites, right, static words and images, and all of a sudden the first thing we wanted to do is we wanted to create stuff, we wanted to do things. We wanted to add comments, we wanted to upload pictures, we wanted to share. It's fascinating. Why? Why did we want to do this? I don't have the answer, but it's really, you know, we take for granted the fact that, yeah, we're creating podcasts. This is a very interesting thing. Instead of just listening to them and letting the big companies push them on us, the first thing we wanted to do is create them. Community. Well, isn't this interesting? We didn't go online to be anonymous in the end. You know, people thought the internet is all about sexual predators and pedophiles. And secrecy, privacy. Not at all. We actually got online and was the first thing we did. Let me connect to people who are like me. Let me see what's out there about marketing. Let me see what's out there about podcasting. Connecting. Okay? Community. Conversations. This is the big thing. But when I talk in general about online marketing, it's all about conversations. As marketers, we don't want to interrupt the conversation. We want to be a part of it. What we're doing every day, everybody in this room, is creating conversations, worldwide conversations. You've got to be able to appreciate for 2 minutes, and this is a great weekend to do this, that this real power, this connecting, this conversation is happening in this room. We are, I mean, look at this room, right? Look around. Look at the people around you. We are the media, right? It's very, very powerful. Check this out. I hope you've all seen this.
This is a Kryptonite Evolution 2000 lock. I used to use this to lock up my bike. around here in Seattle until I found out that you can take a big pen and just remove the top and just pop it into the log and just do a couple of little quick twists and turns, and voila, your log and your bike is completely compromised. So, way to go. Good night.
Way to go, Kryptonite. How many people haven't seen that? Yeah, it amazes me. You haven't or have? Have not? Wow. So, you know, I always get blown away by that. I'm in a room of bloggers and podcasters, and this is really old, by the way. So bloggers, how many people here have a blog? First comment on the blog posting, dude, you need to change the water in your plant. Nobody's freaking out, right? Bloggers are so cynical and we're just so unbelievable, right? So this thing hits the web and Kryptonite Bike Locks goes, no, nothing, they don't say anything. This thing lasts for 20 days. This costs Kryptonite, in terms of damages, close to $18 million. May not seem like a lot of money if you work for a big company, but if you're selling bike locks, $18 million is big. I was actually out of town when this broke, and I came back and I saw this, and I was like, I can't believe this, right? So I hop over to kryptonite.com, nothing on the website. I go to the Evolution 3000 lock product page, nothing on it. Can't believe it, right? Because they acted like a corporation does. In fact, they interviewed the PR person later on, and the head of PR, she had said that we knew about it, we were just going through the proper channels and da-da-da-da, corporations, right? And personal brand, some guy found this and built his personal brand around putting this out there, connecting to others. Kryptonite, which should have had a little disclaimer on their site, probably saying something along the lines of, and I'm not a PR expert, but something along the lines of, there's a video circulating on the internet about this Evolution 3000 lock. If you're presently using this lock, we recommend that you not use it. Enter your email information. We'll contact you as soon as we can validate whether or not it's real or not. They were old school. In a world of personal brands, where personal brands are the media, we are the media, stuff like this moves very quickly. And we have to be ready for it too. I'm not trying to scare you guys in your pockets, but the speed in which this stuff is moving is very important to understand in terms of building that personal brand. We don't have time to sit back. Like, how many people in here have received comments and sort of keep them in queue for 2 days? You can't do that, right? You're being a mean person. I was gonna use a bad word there. I was so tempted, it was just right there. I call it 6 pixels of separation. It's the name of my podcast, and I think it truly expresses what we all can do in terms of personal branding, which is we're no longer 6 degrees of separation away, meaning that if I wanted to connect to anybody in the world, I'm just 6 degrees away from them, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Through that chain, I can get to that person. But we're 6 pixels, which essentially means, is that even right? That we're all intrinsically connected. And that's the big message here, is that you're trying to build your personal brand, you've got to remember that there are very few walls around it. We are intrinsically connected now. This is my wife. I wanted you to meet her. Her nickname is Forbidden. How many people in here have 1 million friends? How many people here can imagine having 1 million friends, right? Besides Chris Penn. They're bots for that, right, Chris? They're scripts if you need them, Chris.
3:30 p.m.
You know, Forbidden has a MySpace page. Her actual name is Christine Dolce. She's from Los Angeles. She's a makeup artist, not anymore. It's not 1 million. It's actually 1.5 million now. One-to-one conversations, leveraging what it is she is, whether it's sexual or whatever her message is, understanding it, how to communicating it, one-to-many conversations. Companies all over the world are trying to get her to speak to her network for them about movies, about everything. She was on the cover of Playboy, in case you're wondering. She got a Playboy deal out of it. Yeah, I understand. She's leveraging her sexuality and all that, but there are other people on MySpace who are not, who also have millions of friends. One person having a one-to-many conversation, how much did this cost her? Zero production, right? My point is we can all do this. You just have to put the effort in if you want to build that type of community. It depends on what you want to do. Second Life, online virtual worlds, right? This is an old one, but this is me. I'm the guy in green. I can actually have hair in Second Life, even green hair. Joseph Jaffe, Neville Hobson, people from all over the world. We were literally on a Skype call to supplement the virtual world experience. And it was absolutely incredible. Building my personal brand by attending events, by networking in virtual worlds with people from the US and the Netherlands and the UK, all connecting. So I want you to start thinking differently about when you're going to these things, especially today is a great example. How are you going to connect? How are you going to have this one-to-many conversation? You can get that out there. LinkedIn, is anyone on LinkedIn? Yeah, good. Well, sign me up, Matt Mitch Joel, find me. So you all know, this shows you that how you can build a personal brand and what the ramifications are. Check this out. 491 contacts, it's up a little more, it's an older slide. 2 degrees away, it's about 30,000. 3 degrees away, I'm connected to over 1 million people. I had an issue last week where we were trying to pitch a client, and there was an intermediate client that was actually Mattel Toys, and it was for an idea. And we couldn't get through to the legal department. It was just really cold calling and not good. Go to LinkedIn, 2 degrees away from the VP of Strategic Alliances. Perfect. Send them the email, we are in. Through LinkedIn. Having a one-to-many conversation, leveraging free tools. This is an online social network for business people. And more, I guess, more older people. What would you say, more older people, I think.
No, really cool people.
Really cool people. That's true, too. I think one man brings it all home, and then I'm out of here. One man understands the internal conversation, the one-to-one conversation, and the one-to-many conversation. Watch this. So you think about that personal branding thing. How many people have seen that before, by the way? So it's amazing, a room full of, I can watch it a million times and feel the same way after, right? Internal conversation. One man is from the UK, spending some time in Australia, 9/11 happens. His passport gets changed. He has to go back. He has an internal conversation. What are my values? What are my goals? What are my beliefs? I believe that people need to change. We got to get beyond this. One-to-one conversation. What's the one simple, concise thing I can do to make that change, to connect to other people? Free hugs. Let me go do this on the street. That stuff happens. How do I expand this to one-to-many? I'll upload it to YouTube, and I'll connect. Millions of people have seen this video. It gets passed along. It gets out there like crazy. What has it done for the personal brand? You know, stuff like that. That's what it does for your personal brand, when you're authentic. I said at the last podcast, Mike Lipkin's line, be you because others are already taken. Right? That's what happens when you're you, when you're authentic about it. And I'm not the only one who thinks so. Right? Time magazine said that you are the person of the year, so get your butts out of here and call your mother and tell her, Mom, I'm the person of the year, did you know? Time magazine is acknowledging that the branding, the days of doing things the old way are over. It's going to be everybody in this room who's going to build their personal brand, build their business, build, be successful because of the individual, not because of someone else. So, that's all I got for you guys. If you want to find me, this is where you can find me. Here's all my contact information. And I hope you have a great 2 days. I will be around, connect, and share, and network, and build your personal brand.